بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد, This is our ninth lesson going through the book رياض الصالحين من حديث سيد المرسلين أوثر بار إمام النووي رحمه الله تعالى. We still in باب الصبر, and we stopped at the hadith of صهيب رضي الله عنه, a hadith which is famously known as the hadith of the boy and the king. And this hadith, generally we teach it to our young children as a story. And it is a very beautiful story that teaches us a number of different lessons, mainly being how to remain steadfast upon this belief that we have, this belief that will guide us to salvation in this world and in the hereafter, and also to be patient upon it. So the importance of believing in it, and how to remain patient, and the examples of those who came before us and how they were patient upon this tawheed, patient upon this wonders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, La ilaha illallah, which is of course the call of all the messengers. And this story has its basis in the Quran. The end of this story, you find it in the chapter of Al-Buruj. Allah says, قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْخُدُودِ النَّارِ ذَاتِ الْوَقُودِ إِذْ هُمْ عَلَيْهَا قُعُودِ وَهُمْ عَلَى مَا يَفْعَلُونَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ شُهُودِ وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ Wallahu ala kulli shay'in shaheed. That the only reason that these people were tortured in the way that they were tortured, and ashabul khudud, the people of the trench, we'll see at the end of the hadith that they were the king who claimed lordship and claimed deity for himself. He set up a big trench. He ordered a big trench to be dug up, and then it to be lit with fire. And then all those who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the oneness of Allah azza wa jalla were thrown into the ditch, or into this trench. And so we learn from that a great lesson, a great moral lesson, in that no matter what happens to you, you never let go of your tawheed. No matter what situation you find yourself in, you never let go of La ilaha illallah, because that is the key to eternal salvation in the hereafter. If you let go of that key and you accept that, or if you let go of that key and you reject that key, then you are not going to be saved in the hereafter, while they're going to be eternally damned to hellfire. And the only ones who will remain eternally in the fire are those who died upon a shirk, died upon the thing that nullifies a person's tawheed. And so that shows us the importance of remaining patient upon tawheed, no matter what situation you may find yourself in. And so we're living in a time of trial, a time where the Muslim ummah is going through difficulties. However, when we go back and we look into our Torah, we see that we're not the first people to go through this. This is not a modern phenomena. Islamophobia is not a modern phenomena. This is something which has been present throughout the ages, even before the advent of Islam. You look at this hadith, and you look at the events that took place in this hadith. It came during a time where, during a time in between Isa and the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And likewise, when you look at the stories of the prophets throughout history, those who were upon this tawheed, this oneness of Allah, which is of course Dinul Anbiya'i Jami'a, the prophets all came with the same call, اُعْبُدُ اللَّهِ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرُهُ وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. And so this call, they were fought, they were killed, they were tortured, they went through so much quote-unquote Islamophobia. And so when we look at our modern situation and the trials that we're going through, some of the trials that we go through may not be as severe as some of the trials that our brothers are going through, and so on. That doesn't mean that it is something which is new, and something which is never been seen before. Rather, it is something which is guaranteed for the one who stays firm upon this tawheed, upon this La ilaha illallah. You will be fought. What did Waraqa ibn Nawfal say to the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when the message came to him? What did he say? That you will be fought and you'll be driven out of your home. And what did the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say? أَوَ مُخْرِجِيَهُمْ. And so what did Waraqa ibn Nawfal reply? مَا مِن نَبِيٍّ. There is no prophet who came with that which you have come with, إِلَّا وَقَدْ أُوذِي. Except that he was harmed, and except that he was driven out by his people. And so this call, La ilaha illallah, you're guaranteed to be harmed. And as we'll see in this hadith, when you look at the rahib, the hermit, the pious monk, what did he say? وَإِنَّكَ سَتُبْتَلَى. And indeed you shall be trialed. That's what he said to the boy. And this is the reality of everybody who accepts his call, and everybody who says La ilaha illallah, that they will be trialed. This is the reality. Because what you've picked up is something which is very heavy, something which is strong, and something which requires from you a great deal of sacrifice. And if you're not willing to do that, and if you're not willing to abide by that, then know that you are on a slippery slope to something which is very, very dangerous. When in sirakhu an tawheed, people leaving tawheed, people apostating from a tawheed due to the smallest affliction that befalls them, you find that these people, were they truly even upon tawheed? Did Islam truly enter into their hearts? Did Iman actually mix into their flesh and into their heart? You have to question that. Because when Abu Sufyan was asked by Heraclius, when he was in his presence, what is the state of those people who accepted the religion of Muhammad? Do they apostate after they enter into his religion? What did he say? He said, La. And what did Heraclius reply? He said, that is how Iman is. حِينَ تُخَالِطُهُ بَشَشَةُ الْقُلُوبَ أو كَمَا قَالَ. When it mixes with the heart, when Iman truly mixes with the heart, then it's very difficult for a person to leave that. When the person realizes that there is none worthy of worship but Allah, and it's become clear for him, and he's now become in line with his natural disposition, how can this person then apostate? And so many of the reasons for apostasy, يعني, it could be a lot of issues, and the main issue could be a lack of Iman in the first place, where you were performing acts of worship like a robot, but truly Iman never actually entered into your heart, and it never mixed with you. And so many a time where you look at occasions of apostasy, and this is maybe a bit of a side point, and we'll see a link back to the hadith itself, where you find that the boy and the blind man who was then cured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the dua of the boy, that they were commanded to apostatize from their religion, to leave their religion. What did the king say? Irji' an dinik, apostate from your religion, right? And so when you look at individuals who are put into such dire situations, yet they still remain firm upon their belief, then you see this is a clear sign of Iman. This is a clear sign of an individual who Iman has mixed with his heart, and it's become one with him, and he has awakened his natural disposition, his fitrah, as opposed to somebody, as I mentioned, at the least inconvenience, يَرْتَدُّ عَنْ دِينِ اللَّهِ. This person, how can you say Iman truly mixed with his heart in the first place? You can just say this person has a superficial upbringing, and يعني, a cultural upbringing, and that's how his Islam was. There was never truly a belief that he had intertwined with him. If that was truly the case, then there is no doubt that this person wouldn't be falling into that which he is falling into, as opposed to those who have firm Iman in their hearts, and Iman has mixed and intertwined into the fabric of their being. طيب, Iman has become their identity. It is them. طيب, this belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they fall into the most severe of trials, that doesn't ever affect their Iman. Rather, it strengthens them and makes their Iman even stronger. And so let's get into the hadith. The hadith is reported by Suhaib al-Rumi again, and we spoke about him briefly in the previous lesson. He narrated, I think, the hadith before last, hadith number 29, I think. And this hadith is found in Sahih Muslim. And there are other yani renditions. There are many other reports. Ibn Ishaq مثلاً goes into a lot of detail concerning this story, and there are many يعني, parts that have been that he mentions in his narration that are not found here. For example, you find people wasting their time looking at who was the boy, who was the king, what was his name, and so on, where did it occur, and all that stuff, which maybe يعني, it's not found in any of the authentic sources, not found in the Quran, not found in the Sunnah or in this hadith. And so one shouldn't يعني, waste their time looking into that intricate details. Rather, there are many other gems and benefits that we can derive from this hadith that we can actually apply in our daily life. Okay, what's his name? Once you know his name, what benefit will that bring you? The name of the boy or the name of the king. There's not really much tangible benefit that one can gain from that information. And so one must always look at information that can be of tangible benefit to him. And so the Messenger of Allah, he said, كان ملك في من كان قبلكم وكان له ساحر. There used to be a king from those who came before us and he used to have a sorcerer. فلما كبر قال للملك إني قد كبرت فبعث إلي غلاما أعلمه السحر. And so the sorcerer said to the king that I have indeed become old, and so send for me a boy who I can teach magic, sorcery. And so, as we know, sorcery is from the nawaqidh of al-Islam, teaching it, learning it, and so on, from the nullifies of al-Islam. And one should completely avoid that, and it's from the nawaqidh of tawheed. فبعث إليه غلاما يعلمه. And so he sent for him a boy. So the king sent for the sorcerer, a boy, to teach him sorcery. And this boy, whilst he was traveling from home to the sorcerer, وكان في طريقه إذا سلك راهب فقعد إليه وسمع كلامه فأعجبه. That whenever this boy would travel from the home that he resided in to the sorcerer, en route he would come across this pious hermit or this pious monk. And the rahib, when you find it in the Nusus Shar'iyya, is generally referring to Ubad and Nasara. It's generally referring to the worshippers from the Christians. فقعد إليه وسمع كلامه. And so the young boy sat with this individual, this rahib, and he listened to what he had to say. And he was amazed by it. And of course, what the rahib was teaching was none other than At-Tawheed, La ilaha illallah. That there is none worthy of worship but Allah. And as you see in the Quran, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? وَمَا نَقَمُوا إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. So this is what he was, this is what this pious monk was teaching the boy. And this is what eventually the boy spread to the people. That there is none worthy of worship but Allah. And that this Allah is the reason why he's worthy of worship is because he's the creator of everything. And he is the sustainer of everything. And so we learn from this that Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, once a person affirms it, what necessitates is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And so the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something which is a necessary act. And it's a necessary reality. Once you've affirmed the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that Allah is the creator, the sustainer and all of that, then what necessary follows is that you worship him subhanahu wa ta'ala the way that he deserves to be worshipped. طيب. And so this is what the pious hermit was teaching. And this, as I said, is the Dinul Anbiya Jami'a, the message of all of the prophets and those who followed them. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ وَلَا عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ هُودًا قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ قَالَ نُوحُ رَبِّي قَالَ نُوحُ وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَى قَوْمِهِ فَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ. طيب. وإلى ثمود أخاهم صالحا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. وإلى مدين أخاهم شعيبا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. طيب. موسى ولمن فرعون what did he say? وتلك نعمة تمنها علي أن عبدت بني إسرائيل قال فرعون وما رب العالمين. The first question that فرعون asked موسى was what? قال فرعون وما رب العالمين. Who is رب العالمين? And what did Musa say? قال رب السماوات والأرض. And so the people, or these messengers, when they come with affirming the rububiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then what necessitates from that is uluhiyyat Allah. أن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو الوحيد المستحق للعبادة هو الواحد الأحد المستحق للعبادة. That he is the only deity worthy of our worship. And so this is the speech that amazed the young boy. And this is the speech that amazes anybody. And this is the whole purpose. You know the arguments for the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of these arguments that you find, whether it be arguments from the kitab, from the sunnah, rational arguments, be it any form of argument, they are not ends in and of itself. They are means. They are means. Means to an end. And that end is to what? Is to awaken the fitrah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, fitrat Allah alati fatara nas alayha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with this natural disposition to worship one Lord. And to recognize one Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as our deity worthy of worship. However, this fitrah becomes clouded and people are blocked from reaching it due to external factors. And so for you to be able to reach that, you use certain means to try and awaken that fitrah. And as soon as that fitrah awakens, and when you ask many of the reverts, a lot of the reverts, if you go on YouTube, you read revert stories and you listen to revert stories, you will find many of the core statements that they make or the core reasons why they came into Islam is what? Is that their fitrah led them to Al-Islam. After performing all sorts of research and all sorts of reading all sorts of rational arguments, eventually something clicked and their fitrah awaked, or their fitrah was awoken, and then they came to Al-Islam. And that is the beauty of this religion, in that it really tugs at the heart and it really gets to one's فطرة. And once that fitra awakens, that's when iman comes into the heart. And so this boy was amazed by the speech of the rahib, the pure speech of the rahib. And so وَكَانَ إِذَا أَتَى السَّاحِرَ مَرَّ بِالرَّاهِبِ وَقَعَدَ إِلَيْهِ فَإِذَا أَتَى السَّاحِرَ ضَرَبَهُ فشكى ذلك إلى الراهب فقال إذا خشيت الساحر فقل حبسني أهلي وإذا خشيت أهلك فقل حبسني الساحر. And so the young boy, he fell into a bit of a pickle, because remember, he's leaving his family and his sorcerer is expecting him, but he's been delayed by sitting with the rahib, who's in between who's en route to destination. He's en route to the destination of the sorcerer. And so when he reaches the sorcerer questions where he's been. And so he hits him because the young boy doesn't want to expose where he's actually been. And so now he made a complaint to the rahib, to the monk, and the monk gave him a solution, a very simple solution, which is that if you go to the sorcerer and the sorcerer asks why are you so late, what caused you to be delayed, say that my family held me back, because the sorcerer knows that you're going to come from your family. And when you reach your family and your family asks you why are you so late, then say to them, the sorcerer held me back. And this is, of course, a kadib, a lie that one is making, the darura. And as we know, lying, the asr, that is not allowed, but it's permissible in cases of necessity. It is permissible in cases of necessity, and this is a necessary situation, right? Because remember, when you look at the context of the region at that time, the sorcerer was a disbeliever. The king claimed lordship, as we'll see later in the hadith. He says what? He says, وَلَكَ رَبٌ غَيْرِي أو كما قال. Do you have a lord other than me, as we'll see the king say? And so it's a country or a region that was filled with shirk, and that their lord was the king. And so the boy couldn't just go out and say, I was with the rahib, the monk, and he was teaching me about tawheed and so on and so on. طيب, that wasn't the time yet. It wasn't yet right to do that. طيب, and so this excuse was used. And as I said, it's out of necessity. And some can say, شَرْعُ قَبْلَنَا, the Sharia of those who came before us, and they have permitted it. And so this story is not binding, or it's not, يعني our Sharia is not binding upon this event which occurred before our Sharia. طيب, and so that can be another way of explaining this. And another way of explaining it is that it's a case of necessity. And it's a very witty excuse, طيب, because you're safe on both sides. And both sides know that you are with the other side, and so you can use that, or you can pay back from it and make it as an excuse. طيب. فبينما هو على ذلك, so whilst he was in this state, إذ أتى على دابة عظيمة قد حبست الناس. One day he came across, whilst attending or whilst being, يعني traveling en route to the ساحر, he came across a huge beast, and this beast had blocked off the pathway. And so it's like, in a modern day, you can put it in a modern day scenario. For example, let's say you're walking or you're going to university method, and you find that there's a huge traffic jam and everybody's backed up, and the reason behind it is a huge lion or a huge beast is blocking everybody. And so the boy used this incident as an opportunity to see whether what he learned from the sahir or what he learned from the rahib, which one is more beloved to Allah and which one is closer to the truth. Remember, he's learning two different ideologies that contradict one another. He's learning the ideology of sorcery, which is the ideology of shirk and kufr, and he's learning the ideology of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ideology and the belief, the pure belief of tawheedullah azza wa jal. And so these two beliefs, they can't be found in the same person. طيب, they are both nullifiers. The one is a nullifier of the other. If you have one, you can't have the other. طيب, and so he wanted to see which of these beliefs is the correct one. And so he sincerely made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, hey, اليوم أعلم, today I will know. الساحر أفضل من الراهب أفضل. Who is better, the sorcerer or the monk? فأخذ حجرا فقال اللهم إن كان أمر الراهب أحب إليك من أمر الساحر فاقتل هذه الدابة حتى يمضي الناس. Oh Allah, if the matter that's with the راهب, i.e. توحيد, is more beloved to you than the matter that's with the sorcerer, which is shirk, then kill this dabba. So I'm going to throw this stone and kill this dabba, kill this beast with that throw that I am making, if the matter of the rahib is more beloved to you than the matter of the sahir. And so this dua, he made it with sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you can tell that he made it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so what happened was, فَرَمَاهَا فَقَتَلَهَا. And so he threw it, and he was able to kill the beast. وَمَضَى النَّاسِ. And the people then went their own way. They were able to باي باس اند جو ثرو. فاتى الراهب فاخبره، فقال له الراهب: اي بني، انت اليوم افضل مني، قد بلغ من امرك ما ارى، وانك ستبتلى، فان ابتليت فلا تدل علي. And so this boy, the Rahib said to him that you are not better than me. This man, the Rahib, who had spent years devoted to the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal, he had secluded himself from the people to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. He had now seen that this protege of his, this young boy of his, had now reached a level and he'd surpassed him. And this young boy, he sensed in him that this is the one who's going to carry the da'wah, and this is the one who's going to call his people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal, and to leave off the worship of this king. And the sincerity of the boy, as I said, it's clear to see. This boy, he makes a dua to Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts his dua. And this is something which, again, we need to have a waqfa over. We have to have a stand over, because many of us, when we make dua, we make dua like it's a robotic thing. Or we make dua as though we expect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to comply with whatever we ask, even though we're not actually coming with the asbab. This young boy, he was truly seeking the truth. You find people who claim to seek truth, who claim to be truth seekers. However, there's biases that they have that they haven't yet taken out from themselves. When a person wants to objectively seek the truth and they are sincerely seeking the truth, they've emptied their cup completely and they are yearning for the truth, haqiqatan, looking for the truth, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide them to the truth. When you look at the likes of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he was an objective truth seeker. He was an objective truth seeker. And so this individual radiallahu anhu, when he saw the truth as being what his people were upon, he was one of the most fierce enemies against al-Islam in the beginning. Then when he heard the recitation of the Qur'an, and he was touched by the recitation of the Qur'an, and he realized that this is the truth, he changed. He accepted it. And he became the greatest supporters of al-Islam. Salman al-Farisi, if you look at the journey that he had, a sincere seeker of truth. Tayyib, he was a sincere seeker of truth. Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail, a man who objectively sought truth. And he died just before the advent of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so when Sa'id ibn Zayd, the son of Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl, asked what is going to happen to my father, the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, سَيُبْعَثُ وَحِيدًا, that Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl, he'll be resurrected alone. And he'll be resurrected upon the Millah of Ibrahim, Hanifa al-Muslima, alayhi rahmatullah. And so if a person is objectively seeking the truth, truly seeking the truth, not people who claim to be seeking the truth, but in reality, they're not seeking the truth. In reality, they have preconceived notions and biases that's preventing them, and they have a cup full, طيب, quote-unquote, metaphorically speaking. طيب, these people, generally, they're not guided to the truth. And if you look at modern revert stories, again, I'll go back to modern revert stories. Many of the time where people talk about their revert story or their reversion or they're coming back to al-Islam, it's generally as a result of what? Sincere seeking of truth. People who spend their day and their night sincerely seeking for the truth, looking for the truth. And they're doing it out of sincerity. طيب, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides whoever he wills. However, if you're somebody who sincerely turns to Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will no doubt turn to you. And this young boy, he sincerely sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knowledge. Knowledge of which is the right path. I am stuck. I don't know which is the right path. Is it the path of the rahib or the path of the sahir? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear for him which path is correct. And once that path became clear to him, he took it. The young boy took it and he went with it and he remained firm upon it. And that's it. We're not turning back after this. And the rahib, he picked up on this. He saw this and he realized now that this boy is of a level now where he's ready. He's ready to go out and preach and spread the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he, as we'll see in the later parts of his stories, that this is something which he was successful in doing so. And even in the methods that he chose, alayhi rahmatullah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy upon this boy, طيب, we see that even in his methods of da'wah, you find ajab al-ujab, very, very amazing methods, showing the wisdom of this young boy. Also, the warning that was given by the rahib إِنَّكَ سَتُبْتَلَى. You'll be trialed. And that's the حقيقة, that's the reality of everyone who claims توحيد. Everybody who is upon لا إله إلا الله, they'll be trialed. They'll be tested. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. And so as we mentioned, for a person, he doesn't leave three states. Either in a state of ni'mah, or in a state of ibtila, or in a state of dhanb. And so how you react to these three states is the way how you react to these three issues, or these three points, or these three stations in one's life, is how happy you are. That it will depend upon how happy you are. If you truly want happiness, then when you are in a state of ni'mah, be grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal. When you are in a state of ibtila, be patient. And when you are in a state of dhanb, return back to Allah in forgiveness. فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ فَإِنَّ هَؤُلَاءِ الثَّلَاثِ عُنْوَانُ السَّعَادَةِ. And so the reality is that we will be trialed. When people look at what's happening to our brothers in China, what's happening to our brothers in the Middle East, what's happening to our brothers in the US, what's happening to our brothers in Europe, in Africa, wherever, in the Muslim world where people are being trialed, this is the reality. The Muslim, he has to accept this, that we will be trialed. This is a haqiqah, this is a reality. And this trialing, or this trial, this is a tribulation, is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see whether we are indeed from the patient ones, and whether we are those who are strivers in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that despite whatever is put in front of us, we still remain firm upon our creed, and upon our belief, and upon our i'tiqadat, and our belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as being the only true deity worthy of our worship. طيب, so even if a saw is put upon your head and you are cut into half, you do not desert and you do not deviate away from la ilaha illallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us that thawat, to grant us that steadfastness. And you won't be able to gain that steadfastness unless you are a true believer in this message. And just look at the people who are performing these protests and all these things that are going on in the Western world today. Why are they doing it? Why are they risking their lives, especially with this COVID-19? Why are they still going out protesting, mass gatherings and whatnot? Why are they doing it? Because they have a cause that they believe in. And they have a sincere belief in that cause. And so if the Muslim has that same sincere belief in his cause, in the cause of making the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highest, then there is no doubt that this individual, whatever is put in front of him, whatever scenario he finds himself in, then that is never ever going to force him to leave or strip himself away from this belief that he held. And so just like these individuals have that belief that they have, and that they will die for that belief, the Muslim also has his belief, and he will die for that belief. اصبروا وصابروا أعني غالبوا الكفار في الصبر, as we spoke about in the previous lesson. And so this patience that we have to hold on to when it comes to ta'atullah, and the patience upon la ilaha illallah, even in the face of trials, this is something which we have to do. You have to be more patient than the kuffar. So the kuffar have their own causes, and they have their own beliefs that they remain firm upon, and that they're strongly patient on. We have our own causes, and we need to be more patient on those causes than they are on their causes. Because when it comes, when reality comes, we need to be ready. We need to be ready, and we need to be firm upon our creed and upon our beliefs. طيب. وَكَانَ الْغُلَامُ يُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ وَيُدَاوِي النَّاسَ مِنْ سَائِرِ الْأَدْوَاءِ فَسَمِعَ جَلِيسٌ لِلْمَلِكِ كَانَ قَدْ عَمِي. And so the young boy was given this disability from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure the blind and to cure the lepers. And so, as we know, the cure is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we'll see the boy, he says, إِنِّي لَا أَشْفِي أَحَدًا إِنَّمَا أَشْفِي اللَّهِ. We'll see it. طيب. And so this boy, just like Isa alayhi salam, was able to what? يُبْرِعُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ وَيُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى وَأُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, with the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب. And so a man who used to be from the courtiers of the king, and he was blind, he heard about this young boy. فأتاه, and so he came to him, and he came with him بهدايا كثيرة. قال ما ها هنا لك أجمع إن أنت شفيتني. And so the blind man, he said to the boy, that all this gifts that I have brought, they are all for you, if you are able to cure me. And so the boy then made a profound statement. إني لا أشفي أحدا. I do not cure anybody. إنما يشفي الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who cures. وهذا هو الحقيقة. What did Ibrahim say? وإذا مرضت فهو يشفين. فهو يشفين. It is Allah who cures. The boy doesn't cure. And so this is a another lesson that we can extract from this statement, especially and applying it into our modern, in our modern context, especially with the COVID-19, is that people genuinely believe that the cure is in the hands of the doctor, and so they'll say method and subconsciously that the doctor cured me. The doctor never cured you. Allah cured you. That's the aqeedah of the Muslim. And so when one says that the doctor cured me and it is the medicine that cured me, then this could potentially be shirk. Could potentially be shirk. طيب. And so one must avoid that. Of course, the intention is never shirk. That's not what the person is intending by it. Of course, the person, the Muslim especially, knows that it is Allah who cures. But these kind of statements are very dangerous that we should try to avoid. Rather, just we should be like the boy. The boy knew and he realized and he had full knowledge that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who cures. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created us. And if Allah can create us, then of course it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can cure us from the ailments that we may find ourselves in. طيب. However, that doesn't mean that we don't come with the asbab. Just because we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has the cure, and then it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who cures us, that doesn't mean that we just sit at home and we don't come with the asbab. لا. The doctor is supposed to do his job. The patient, or in this case, the one who is sick, is supposed to do his job by taking the medicine that he has been told to take. However, we don't believe in the medicine as being the reason for our cure. Rather, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who cures us. طيب. So that is our aqeedah. And so the boy said to the man, the blind man, فَإِنْ آمَنْتَ بِاللَّهِ If you believe in Allah, دَعَوْتُ اللَّهَ فَشَفَاكَ I will call upon Allah and he will cure you. فَآمَنَ بِاللَّهِ And so the man believes in Allah. فَشَفَاهُ اللَّهِ And so Allah cured him after the dua of the young boy. And so the man now came back to the sitting and the gathering and the court of the king, as he used to sit before. And so the king said to him, مَنْ رَدَّ عَلَيْكَ بَصَرُكَ Who was the one who returned your eyesight to you? فَقَالَ رَبِّي My Lord. And so the king said, and this is مِنْ وَقَاحَتِهِ أَوَلَكَ رَبٌ غَيْرِي Do you have a Lord other than me? Showing us that this person what? He claimed divinity or claimed lordship for himself. And as we know, الرب هو الله ربي وربك الله as the man said, the ex-blind man said, ربي وربك الله My Lord and your Lord is Allah. And so this blind man, he now had what? Iman entered into his heart. باشرت قلبه Iman mixed with his heart. And because of this, he now became a person who was certain upon his belief. And so whether he was in the gathering of the king or the gathering of anybody else, he was going to say whatever he now believed in. And he was now sincere in his belief. And so he said it, Rabbi wa Rabbuk Allah, My Lord and your Lord is Allah. Because he had seen it firsthand. He was now in tune with his fitrah. That encounter with the young boy enabled him to what? To be in tune with his natural disposition. And when the person is in tune with his natural disposition, that is when he will see true happiness. And when a person sees true happiness, then why would I go back to darkness? I've now been guided into the light. Nothing will force me to go back to that period of darkness that I was in. And this is how this man was. The period of darkness when he was blind, he never wants to go back to it. And so he literally came with the hadith kalimatu haqqin inda sultanin ja'ir. He made the truthful statement in front of a unjust ruler. And this ruler who is claiming divinity for himself and claiming lordship for himself. فَأَخَذَهُ And so the king took the blind man and began torturing him. فَلَمْ يَزَلْ يُعَذِّبُهُ حَتَّى دَلَّ عَلَى الْغُلَامِ فَجِئَ بِالْغُلَامِ فَقَالَ لَهُ الْمَلِكُ أَيْ بُنَيَّ قَدْ بَلَغَ مِنْ سِحْرِكَ مَا تُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ وَتَفْعَلُ وَتَفْعَلُ And so the blind man continuously was tortured until he gave up the young boy. And so they brought the young boy to the king, and the king said to him, Oh my son, oh boy, you have reached a level of magic or a level of sorcery. And so remember, it was the king who brought the young boy to the sorcerer in the first place, to become an apprentice to the sorcerer, right? And so here, the king is attributing this person's abilities, attribution to magic and to sorcery. He thinks that what this person is doing, what this young boy is doing, in curing the sick and yani and those who are lepers, those who have that skin disease of leprosy, right? He attributes it to sorcery, so he attributes it to magic, and so this person is committing kufr upon kufr. Number one, he committed the kufr of saying that he is Lord, and number two, he's attributing a right that belongs solely to Allah Azza wa Jal to other than Allah, and he's attributing it to sorcery. He's attributing something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does to sorcery. وَهَذَا كُفْرٌ أَيْضًا. And so the boy said, إِنِّي لَأَشْفِي أَحَدًا. I don't cure anybody. And that's the reality. The boy doesn't cure anybody. It is Allah who cures. إِنَّمَا يَشْفِي اللَّهِ. And so the king took him. فَذَمَتَ يُعَذِّبُهُ. And so he continued torturing him. حَتَّى دَلَّ عَلَى الرَّاحِبِ. Until the young boy confessed to the king regarding the monk. فَجِيَ بِالرَّاحِبِ. Then the rahib was brought. فَقِيلَ لَهُ إِرْجِعْ عَنْ دِينِكَ. And it was set him apostate from your religion. And so this is what all of these individuals who are enemies to Allah Azza wa Jal, this is what they want from you. They don't even want necessarily that you accept their way of life or their path or their religion. They just want you to leave your religion. That's what they want. They don't even care if you enter into Christianity or Judaism or any other religion. Just leave La ilaha illallah. Because as we know, Al-Kufr millatun wahida. Kufr is one millah. It's all the same. طيب. They just want you to commit disbelief. What did the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he say in the Quran? وَدُّوا لَوْ تَكْفُرُونَ كَمَا كَفَرُوا فَتَكُونُونَ سَوَاءً. طيب. وَدُّوا لَوْ تَكْفُرُونَ. They hope and they wish that you disbelieve, just like they disbelieve, so that you be equal. It doesn't matter whether this one's a Jew or that's an atheist or that's an agnostic or that's a Hindu. They're all disbelievers and they're all equal. So this Hindu, he doesn't care if you enter into his belief or accept his belief. He doesn't care, as long as you're not a Muslim. And so this king, he didn't offer the rahib to accept him as the Lord. لا. He just wanted this rahib to leave his religion. And this is what the Ahlul Batil are upon. However, Allah said, وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقِّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا. Indeed, truth has come and it has demolished falsehood, or indeed, falsehood was bound to perish. And so the rahib, he refused. فَأَبَى فَدَعَى بِالْمِنْشَارِ فَوَضِعَ الْمِنْشَارُ فِي مَفْرِقِ رَأْسِهِ فَشَقَّهُ حَتَّى وَقَعَ شِقَّهُ. And so here, when the rahib refused, the king ordered for a saw to be brought, and it was placed upon the head of the rahib, and then he was sawn in half. He was sawed in half. And this is a reference, or this part of the hadith, the Messenger of Allah references it in another hadith. When Khabbab ibn al-Arat, radiallahu anhu, yeah, he was one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, who was tortured severely in Mecca. And he came to the Messenger ﷺ complaining about the torture that he was suffering in Mecca. And so the Messenger of Allah ﷺ wanted to highlight to Khabbab ibn al-Arat what the people before him had gone through for the same cause that you are going through right now. And he mentioned the story of a person who al-Minshar would be brought, that a saw would be brought and be placed upon his head, and would be asked to leave his religion, and he refused, and he will be sawn in half. And one side of the body will fall on the left, and the other side of the body will fall towards the right. And that still wouldn't prevent them from saying what? Or from apostating from their religion. Showing us that we may be going through a tough times, quote-unquote Islamophobia, our brothers being put in concentration camps, and that's a reality. Going through a lot of trials in India, our brothers being lynched, and so on. طيب. However, us as Muslimin, we need to realize that this cause that we are fighting for, this Tawheed that we are fighting for, there are those who came before us who went through far, far worse than we are going through. And that didn't stop them from, and that didn't cause them to deviate from their cause. Rather, the cause remained. And it remained high. And they were eventually given victory. أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ. And so we as Muslimin, despite the trials that they're going through, we need to be certain that the victory of Allah is near. The victory of Allah is near. All we have to do is remain patient and work. Work hard. Come with the asbab to try and uplift ourselves from the doldrums that we find ourselves in and the trials that we find ourselves in. So we remain patient, we remain certain, and we remain confident, and we remain firm upon and remain steadfast upon this reality that we have, which is the truth, al-haq. The one who stands with the truth will stand with him. With him. And the solution is not to perform tamyi' to water down our religion. The solution is not to leave our religion. The solution is not to look into other isms, طيب, other ways of life. That's not the solution. The solution is remaining firm upon La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and then working hard and striving to make the word of Allah highest. من قاتل لتكون كلمة الله هي العليا فهو في سبيل الله. Now we strive to make the religion highest, to make the word of Allah highest. وقاتلوهم حتى لا تكون فتنة ويكون الدين كله لله أو يكون الدين لله. That's when we, that is the goal that we are looking for. That is the goal that we are striving towards. أن يكون الدين كله لله. That is, religion belongs all to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why the Sahaba live their life. من المهدي إلى اللحد. That is our message. And that is our call. That's what we remain upon. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. We call it, we call to it, we propagate it. Wherever we can, any opportunity that we can find. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. Because that is our key to paradise. And our key and our shield that will prevent us from the fire. Then the hadith continues. ثم جاء بجليس الملك فقيل له ارجع عن دينك أبا فوضع المنشار في مفرق رأسه فشقه به حتى وقع الشقاء ثم جاء بالغلام. And so the same happened to the blind man as well. He was also brought and he was asked, he was commanded to apostate. He refused, and so the minshar, the sword, was brought and he was cut in half. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy upon him and upon the rahib. As for the boy, then he was brought, ثم جاء بالغلام فقيل له ارجع عن دينك فأبى. And so he refused as well to apostate from his religion. فدفعه إلى نفر من أصحابه. And look at the sabr. This young boy must have seen his teacher sawn in half. He must have seen his friend, the blind man whom he had encountered with, also sawn in half. Yet that didn't ever affect him in a way that would lead him to apostate from his religion. Look at the sabr, the steadfastness and the patience that he had, which is the purpose of why the hadith is being brought in the chapter of Bab al-Sabr. That even if your brothers are going through trials and tribulations, and yani your family, مثلا, your brother is going through a very, very difficult situation and you can't do much about it, طيب, that shouldn't lead you to despairing from the mercy of Allah or to not be patient. Rather, that trial should lead you to gain more patience and to be patient upon this qadarullah, this decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and lest you be from the verses or from those ansara, you can be from those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ أُولَئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ مُهْتَدُونَ. And so this boy refused, فَدَفَعَهُ إِلَى نَفَرٍ مِنْ أَصْحَابِهِ. And so the author, the king, he commanded that this boy be taken by a number of his people. So the king ordered some of his subjects to take the boy to the Jabal kada wa kada, to a mountain, such and such mountain. فصعدوا به الجبل. And so climb up the mountain with him. فإذا بلغتم ذروته, if you reach the peak of the mountain, فإن رجع عن دينه وإلا فاطرحوه. Ask him to return from his religion, to apostate. If he doesn't apostate, then throw him off the mountain. And so they went and they performed this. And they climbed up the mountain with him. And the boy then made the dua. فقال, the boy made the dua. اللهم اكفنيهم بما شئت. Oh Allah, save me from them in any way possible. That's a wrong translation. اللهم اكفنيهم بما شئت. Oh Allah, save me from them in any way that you wish. بما شئت. And this is a very beautiful dua. That the boy, number one, he was certain. كان موقنا. He was very, very certain. And so he said, اللهم اكفنيهم. Allah, save me from them. In any way you wish. Any way you wish, oh Allah. Save me from them. And if you changed bima to in, then this is a form of dua that we shouldn't make. Because that dua has a dua which you are conditioning upon Allah. You're saying, oh Allah, ikfinihim in shit. You shouldn't say that. And that is يعني, a mas'ala which is fiqhiyah, that a person when he's making dua, he has to, from the etiquette of making dua, is that he does it with certainty. He doesn't do it by placing conditions and so on. And so here the boy didn't make any condition. Rather, he said, Allahumma ikfinihim, oh Allah, save me from them, bima shit, in any way that you can. Or in any way that you wish. And also in any way that you can, that's a wrong translation as well. And we shouldn't say that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يفعل ما يشاء. Allah is capable of doing all things. And so we say Allahumma ikfinihim bima shit. Shit is in whatever way you wish. In whatever way you wish. فَرَجَّفَ بِهِمُ الْجَبَلُ فَسَقَطُوا. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he caused the mountain to shake. And all of the people who were with the boy, they fell to their deaths. As for the boy, he was saved and he came back walking to the king. فقال له الملك أو فقال له الملك وجاء يمشي إلى الملك فقال له الملك ما فعل أصحابك. What did your friends, and what we mean by أصحابك here, i.e. those who are with you, those who accompanied you, the linguistic meaning of أصحاب. ما فعل أصحابك. فقال كفانيهم الله. That Allah سبحانه وتعالى saved me from them. فدفعه إلى نفر من أصحابه فقال اذهبوا به. And so now he gave him another group of his subjects. And he said, take this boy and put him on a qurqur. فَحْمِلُوهُ فِي قُرْقُورٍ. Qurqur is a small boat. وَتَوَسَّطُوا بِهِ الْبَحْرِ. Take him to the middle part of the sea, i.e. no man's land. فَإِنْ رَجَعَ عَنْ دِينِهِ. If he apostates from his religion, then bring him back. And if he doesn't, فَقْذِفُوهُ. Throw him off, i.e. throw him into the sea. فَذَهَبُوا بِهِ. And so they went with him. فَقَالَ. And he said, and he made another dua, the same dua that he made the first time. Allahumma kfinihim bima shit. Oh Allah, save me from them in any way that you wish. فانكفأت بهم السفينة. And so the safina tipped upside down. It flipped upside down. فغرقوا. And so they drowned. وجاء يمشي للملك. And so all the people that were with him drowned. Whereas he was saved and he came back walking to the king. فقال له الملك. And so the king said to him, ما فعل أصحابك. Same question. What did your people, i.e. those who are with you, those who accompanied you, do? فقال كفانيهم الله. Allah saved me from them. And look again, the boy's certainty. It's not him doing it. This is not sorcery. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doing these things. And so he has complete faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a wali, a true wali from awliya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who have no huzn, no sadness. Look at this man. There was no element of sadness, no element of doubt. Even when he was climbing up the mountain, even when he was going into the sea and he went to the middle part of the sea, into no man's land, where it's pitch black. طيب. Even in those cases of difficulty, he never doubted even one second, this young boy. And he's a boy. He never doubted for one second. Rather, he had complete sincerity and belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's how iman is. When you taste true iman, it's very difficult to come away from it. Or in fact, it's impossible to come away from it. Illa, except if you start falling into that which displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you start falling into that which displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will eventually, your iman will weaken and weaken and weaken and weaken and weaken until it may completely desert you. But what was the cause of that iman deserting you was yourself by performing acts that displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you're a person who remains firm upon the iman with i'tiqad al-sahih, and then he affirms that iman with correct belief, correct aqidah, and also living a life of worship, living a life of ta'ah, just like this boy, then iman will remain strong in you. And that's how it is from the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah. And that iman yazidu wa yanqus, that iman rises and decreases as well. طيب, iman doesn't just completely desert a person in one go just because he performed one sin. لا. Rather, it's a gradual process. And so when you fall into a sin, what do we say in order for a person to become one of the people of happiness? That he returns back to forgiveness. And of course, returning back to forgiveness is an act of worship itself. And so this young boy, you see him, sincerity that he held, the iman that he has, yani it's of a frighteningly high and a level which many of us would dream to reach. And you look at all the trials that he's going through, and yet he's remaining firm. And there is never any hint of doubt or any hint of yani tadabdub, none of that. There is no such thing. When he's taken up to the peak of the mountain, he's firm. He's calling upon Allah alone. When he's taken to the depths of the sea, he's calling upon Allah alone. Whatever state that he's in, he's calling upon Allah alone. Now when he's asked, what did you do or what happened? He is returning the favor back to Allah. This is a man who completely came with those 3 points that I mentioned. He is what? When he's got a ni'mah, he's grateful to Allah. When he's in the state of ibtila, he is sabirun muhtasibun. He is a person who is patient and seeking the reward from Allah. And number three, when he's in the state of what? Then, but that doesn't necessarily come in this hadith, where we don't see it, with the third one we don't really see. Yet he's continuously, the first two points especially, it's very profound in this hadith. He is what? Every single ni'mah, every single blessing, he's returning and being grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal. And every single trial, he's being what? Sabirun muhtasibun. Returning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, constantly seeking his aid and his assistance. And so this person is somebody who's truly attached himself to his Lord Jalla Jalaluhu. And so then the king said to him, after asking him, مَا فَعَلَ أَصْحَابُكَ فَقَالَ كَفَانِيهِمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. And then the boy said to the king, that you will not be able to kill me. إِنَّكَ لَسْتَ بِقَاتِلِي. You will not kill me حَتَّى تَفْعَلَ مَا أَمُرُكَ بِهِ. That you will not be able to kill me until you do what I command you to do. And so this is one of the greatest parts of the hadith as well, in that he took this as an opportunity now to truly expose this king for the fraud that he is. Remember, the king claimed what? That he is the true Lord. He said, وَلَكَ رَبٌّ غَيْرِي. Right? He claimed to be the Lord. And so the king has this position where he thinks that he is the Lord, and the people, the subjects, all believe that he is the Lord, worthy of worship. And so now the boy wants to make da'wah. And he's now taking this as an opportunity to truly expose the king as a fraud, and to expose to the people that their Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that he is the one who benefits, and he is the one who gives life and takes life, and he is the one who is worthy of our worship. Because Ar-Rabb huwa al-mustahiqu lil-ibadah, the one who is the Lord, he is the one worthy of our worship. And so to expose this reality to the people, he commanded the king to do certain things. And you see that when he commands him to do these certain things, that the intent behind it is it's unequivocally clear, in that he wants the people to see the reality of what the king is upon, and what the boy is upon, and that they reject the religion of the king and they accept the religion of the boy, and that they reject the shirk and they accept the tawheed al-khalis. And so what did the boy say? He said, تَجْمَعُ النَّاسَ فِي صَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ. You gather the people on one plane. وَتَصْلُوبِنِي عَلَى جِذْعٍ. And then you tie me onto a jidr. A jidr refers to the trunk of a tree. وَهُزِّ إِلَيْهِ بِجِذْعِ النَّخْلَةِ. The trunk of the nakhla, which is the jidr. ثُمَّ خُذْ سَهْمًا. And take an arrow from كِنَانَتِي, from my quiver. ثُمَّ ضَعِ السَّهْمَ فِي كَبِدٍ قَوْسٍ. And then place that arrow into the bow. And then say, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. Say, in the name of Allah, the Lord of the boy. ثُمَّ ارْمِي. And then throw the arrow. Shoot the arrow. فَإِنَّكَ إِذَا فَعَلْتَ ذَلِكَ. If you do this, قَتَلْتَنِي. You have killed me. فَجَمَعَ النَّاسَ فِي صَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ. And so the king gathered the people on one plane. And so now all the people are there. All of the subjects are there. And they're going to witness this. They're going to witness the king take a bow from the quiver of the boy. They're going to see the king put the bow on his arrow, and they're going to hear the king say, Bismillahi Rabbil Ghulam, in the name of Allah, the Lord of the boy. And then he's going to shoot. And the boy is going to die. And the people are going to see that indeed, and the people must have known what had happened previously, the previous two occasions, of course, it would have been public knowledge. Right? So now they will see that this man, or this king, he is not the Lord. Rather, the Lord is the one who killed this boy. Bismillah, Rabbil Ghulam. It's in the name of Allah, the Lord of the boy, that he was able to kill this boy. And when he commanded his subjects to go and take him to the mountain and take him to the sea, they were unable to do any harm to him. But as soon as the name of Allah was mentioned, then the reality became clear. And so these people would then accept Islam, or accept the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is of course al-Tawheed, la ilaha illallah. As you see in the hadith, فجمع الناس في صعيد واحد وصلبهم على جذع، ثم أخذ سهما من كنانته، ثم وضع السهم في كبد القوس، ثم قال بسم الله رب الغلام، ثم رماه فوقع السهم في صدغه. When he threw the arrow, when he shot the arrow hit the temple of the boy, and the boy put his hand on his temple, فمات and he died. فقال الناس, and the people then exclaimed, آمنا برب الغلام. This is the reality now. The people had seen the truth right in front of their eyes. They had seen the reality of this king, that he's a fraud and that he's not the Lord worthy of our worship. Rather, it is the Lord of the boy that is worthy of our worship, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so just by this act, the boy had turned an entire community against the king. He had turned an entire community from being mushrikeen to now being what? Muwahideen. And these are the people who would then be thrown into the trenches of fire, as we see in the next part of the hadith. آمنا برب الغلام فأوتي الملك فقيل له أرأيت ما كنت تحذر قد والله نزل بك حذرك قد آمن الناس. And so as you can see here, the people, it was said to the king that now what you were fleeing from has occurred, which is that the people have now believed. What you are fleeing from has now occurred. The boy has exposed you. You are now no longer the deity that these people are taken as a lord. Rather, they have realized that the true Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabb al-Ghulam, the Lord of the boy. And so they began worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this man, he was from the shirar al-khalq. And so he commanded, فَأَمَرَ بِالْأُخْدُودِ بِأَفْوَاهِ السِّكَكِ فَخُدَّتْ. And so he commanded that trenches be built. وَأُضْرِمَ فِيهَا النِّيرَانَ. And then it was lit with fire. وَقَالَ مَنْ لَمْ يَرْجِعْ عَنْ دِينِهِ فَأَقْحِمُوهُ فِيهَا. Now whoever doesn't apostate from his religion, i.e. this newfound religion for these people, that they are going to worship Allah alone, and they're going to worship the Lord of the boy, then throw him into the fire. أَوْ قِيلَ لَهُ اِقْتَحِمْ فَفَعَلُوا. And so this occurred. The soldiers of Kufr and the A'wan of Dhalama, they brought the people who had worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, who had accepted the religion of the boy, and if they disbelieved, then they will be saved. And if they didn't disbelieve, and if they remain firm upon their belief, then they will be what? They will be thrown into the fire. And as you can see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlighted this in Surah Al-Buruj. وَمَا نَقَمُوا إِلَّا أَنْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. The only reason why these people were treated in that way was because of their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Aziz al-Hamid. And so then there came a woman, حَتَّى جَاءَتْ إِمْرَأَةٌ وَمَعَهَا صَبِيٌّ لَهَا فَتَقَاعَسَتْ أَنْ تَقَعَ فِيهَا. And so a woman came, and she had with her a newborn child. And her previous children had all been thrown into the fire as well. But she tried to, but she what? She hesitated. Why did she hesitate? Because of the young child. And this is the rahmah of the mother to her child. And when the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he compares, and he says that Allah arhamu min al-walidati biwaladiha wa kama qal, that Allah is more merciful to a mother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more merciful to his creation than more so than a mother is merciful to her child. Look at this hadith. This young woman, who is a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she has this firm belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's not because of her that she's hesitated, it's because of the young newborn child. It is that mercy that's within her, this rahmah that's within her, that's forced her to hesitate in going into the fire. And so the ghulam, the child, that newborn child, thabbataha, he reassured her by saying, Ya ummah, usbiri, fa'innaki ala al-haq. And this specific statement is why the author, rahimahullah, now he brought this hadith under this chapter. Usbirihi, be patient, for indeed you are upon the truth. And this is a profound message. And this is a message that I want to send to every single Muslim who's in the state of Karb, in the state of Shiddah, because of their religion. Our Muslims in the Ighwir concentration camp, our Muslims in India being lynched, our Muslims in the Muslim world, in the Arab world, and all these countries where they are being persecuted for La ilaha illallah. I want to say to them, اصبري أو اصبروا فإنكم على الحق. Be patient, for indeed you are upon the truth. Be patient, for indeed you are upon the truth. And so this woman was then pushed into the fire. And this, of course, this child was given this ilham. And this is one of the four cases, or four known cases, in which a young child, still a newborn, was able to speak. Another case which is found in the Quran is the story of Isa alayhi salam. قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ أَتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا. Likewise, this young boy, اصبري فإنك على الحق. Likewise we have the وشهد شاهد من أهلها in سورة يوسف. طيب, and there's a fourth case as well. I can't quite remember that one right now, but these are the four cases in which it is mentioned that a young child spoke whilst still in the Mahd, whilst still in the newborn phase. And so this hadith is a very, very beautiful hadith that teaches us how to be steadfast upon at-tawheed, teaches us the benefits of at-tawheed, and that at-tawheed is the only way in which a person will gain salvation in the hereafter. And look at these individuals all gaining shuhash, the station of martyrdom, just because of their firmness and steadfastness upon at-tawheed, and that no matter what happens, no matter what situation we find ourselves in, we have to remain firm upon it. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. That is how we live our life. Biha namut wa biha نحيا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Submitting to what? Submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Submitting to the reality that there is none worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger, and that we must remain patient upon that. And as we know, when it comes to matters that we have to have knowledge of, they are four, right? اعلم أنه يجب علينا تعلم أربع مسائل. الأولى العلم, الثانية العمل, الثالثة الدعوة إليه والصبر على الأذى فيه. Number four. So you have to be upon these four issues. Knowledge of لا إله إلا الله, right? Acting upon لا إله إلا الله, calling others to لا إله إلا الله, and being patient upon it. And this hadith, it's an application, a example of a case study, you could say, where these four matters are put to use and actually applied. This young boy, عَلِمَ, he learnt لا إله إلا الله from the راحل. عَمِلَ بِهَا, he acted upon it. دَعَى إليه, he called to it, and he died upon it. وَصَبَرَ عَلَيْهِ, and he was patient upon it. وَمَاتَ عَلَيْهَا. And so that is how we should be as well when it comes to our when it comes to us and how we deal with لا إله إلا الله. أن نتعلمه, that we learn it. وأن نعمل به, that we act upon it. وأن ندعو إليه, that we call to it. And that we remain patient upon it. هذا والله أعلم. مصطفى بإذن الله. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.